Yesterday, the keynote speaker spoke about a couple of women writers who he said were the only women writing in English at the beginning, around the beginning or the first half of the 20th century. I would suggest that instead of looking for women writers in English, we need to find them in the languages that they wrote in, which need not necessarily, given that we are looking at new perspectives from non-native literatures. And in the context of Muslim women, perhaps you would also find them in Urdu. One of the writers, one of such writers is Mumtaz Shahnawaz, who has written a novel and a few poems. This paper is going to look at her novel. The paper proposes to argue that women's writings offer powerful critiques of neat demarcations between the public sphere and the private domain, to read facts and fictions against each other, to read for how literary narratives influence and are influenced by contemporary socio-political issues. This paper will examine Mumtaz Shahnawaz's The Heart Divided, 1948, as a coming-of-age narrative set during nationalist moments of early to mid-20th century that suggests the issue of women's problems was too complex to be presented only in the context of family through a woman's identity as a private being. All right, I've divided the paper in three sections. The first one will do a quick review of early moves to educate women, particularly Muslim women. Section two will look at the text and try to draw textual evidences from The Heart Divided. And three, section three will try to sketch out the implications of such texts for the fictions of our understanding of contemporary concerns. Right, around the turn of the 20th century, there, perhaps some of us would know, there were several initiatives to publish newspapers and periodicals for women. There's a great deal of concern to educate women into modern life. One effect of this was to initiate women into the world of writing and publishing. For example, Akhbar-un-Nisa and Muallim and Iswan are the earliest known journals for women. Akhbar-un-Nisa was founded in 1887 in Delhi by Syed Ahmed Dehelvi, a lexicographer who had also compiled a dictionary of Begamati Zaban, the idiomatic Urdu spoken by women, under the patronage of the Begum of Bhopal. His periodical, however, did not survive long. The Muallim and Iswan was a monthly begun in the late 1880s. And published for about 14 years by Maulvi Mohabbe Hussain in Hyderabad. It was ultimately stopped by the Hyderabad government in response to objections over Mohabbe Hussain's attacks on Parda. It was a one-man show with articles written mostly by Mohabbe Hussain. He also published reviews of books concerning women and serialized literary works such as Abdul Halim Sharar's novel Badrunisa Ki Musibat, a social novel with an anti-Parda message. A major weekly newspaper of this early period was Tehzeeb-e-Nuswan, published by Mumtaz Ali and Mohammadi Begum.
We need to recognize that the overall purpose of task is the same as exercises, learning a language. The difference lying in the means by which this purpose is to be achieved. Quotes ended. To quote Ellis Road again, within quotes, a task requires the participants to function primarily as language users, in the sense that they must employ the same kinds of communicative process as those involved in real-world activities, unquote. According to Widdowson, 1978, learners will need to pay attention to both meaning and form in both tasks and exercises. Difference between a task and an exercise is not depend on form and meaning, but the kind of meaning involved in it. Task is concerned with, within quotes, pragmatic meaning, unquote, that is, the use of language in context, while exercise is concerned with semantic meaning, that is, the meanings that specific forms can convey irrespective of context. Although exercises are important in the learning process, the tasks and task-based learning are very effective when it comes to second language learning, especially in a country like India, where we have typically large classes and heterogeneous groups. Task-based learning is effective because it involves real-life communication, gives focus to communication and meaning rather than form, process rather than product, engages learners in tasks, provides a better context for the activation of learning process by interacting communicatively and purposefully while engaged in tasks and has sequenced according to difficulty. Another point, kinds of tasks and activities. According to Noonan, real world tasks, these are designed to practice, fulfill the important and useful needs in real life situation. Using telephone is the example of this kind of this task. Second, pedagogical tasks. These tasks are, have a psycholinguistic basis in second language acquisition theory and research, but do not necessarily reflect real world tasks. Third one, information task, is an example of the pedagogical task. Another person, Mr. N.S. Prabhu, used a variety of activities and tasks in Bangalore project for primary age of learners in English. They are information gap activity, which requires exchange of information to complete these activities, reasoning gap activity, which involves extracting new information from given information through inference, deduction, practical reasoning, or perception of relationships and patterns. Opinion gap activity, here learners go beyond the information given by supplying their own ideas. Information is shared by the members and negotiation is optional. Again, Prabhu proposes illustrative tasks in his book, Second Language Pedagogy. Some of the tasks that can be typically given are diagrams, formations, drawing, clock faces, monthly calendar, maps, school timetables, programs, and etc. English language can be used for different purposes in various fields. Engineering students require specific vocabulary to study the subjects of their field. They also need to communicate in classroom, at the interview board for the jobs, and at the workplace with different people. To communicate with different people for various purposes, they require communication skills in English, especially spoken communication skills. To acquire spoken communication skills, they must acquire general English for communication, and this can be done best with the use of task-based learning, language learning. Another point, research methodology, data and tools. It is quantitative data. The data are collected through questionnaires and interviews from 180 engineering students of three engineering colleges, faculty members, and human resource managers in Hyderabad. Data analysis, the 90% of the students have expressed their difficulty in communicating in English at various contexts and wanted these skills to overcome their difficulties during and after their course. Fourth one, task designing. The tasks are prepared based on general needs of engineering students on the basis of their needs analysis. According to the needs analysis, the students require English language for their general purposes rather than specific subject-related needs. But these tasks will help them in specific contexts and also improve their general fluency at their later stages. The task bank has 11 interactive tasks that can be termed as task-based communicative activities. They aim at improving the spoken communication skills of engineering students at the undergraduate level. The groups could be typically heterogeneous. The tasks have the following framework, like rational, time frame, mode of activity, teaching material, situation, pre-task, task, and post-task. To elaborate these, rational looks at the object or needs of each task. The allotted time framework is 1 hour. The mode of activity includes pair and group works. The teaching material used here is cue cards. These cue cards are also called clue cards, in which hints or clues are given in the form of expressions, words, in jumbled order. Then the learner has to read, discuss, reorder, write complete sentences, and present to the class orally. In every task, every learner gets a card. The instructions are given in the card to guide the learner to do a task. Every task created a real-life situation to think, discuss, and enact through role plays. Procedure. This talks about all the steps involved in the task, like dividing class into pairs or groups, distributing cards, making them to read, discuss, reorder, and present to the class, and finally asking other students and teacher to give comments on the presented tasks. Stages of task. Pre-task, this is the first one. It is the first stage in the task to motivate the learners to get ready to do task. Post-task, it is the second stage in which the learners actually perform the task. Post-task, it is the last stage in which the learners get feedback on the performed task for better performance. The tasks are designed on 11 aspects. They are self-introduction, partner introduction, job interview, informal telephonic communication, formal telephonic communication, giving directions, asking for information, and giving directions, classroom communication, informal apology and excuse, formal apology and excuse, and debate. Conclusion, the findings are like this. In this paper, the prepared 11 tasks can be used as an effective tool to develop general communicative fluency among the engineering students. The present study identified the needs of the general spoken communication skills for engineering students through needs analysis. This analysis was based on responses collected from three engineering colleges of Jawaharlal Nehru Technological University, Andhra Pradesh. It revealed that the students need spoken communication skills in academic and professional settings. Then the researcher prepared communicative tasks to develop the general spoken communication skills for them. It is evident that there is a need to improve engineering students' spoken communication in various contexts and situations. This is very important both at entry and post-entry level. Although writing skills are important, it is only at the higher managerial level that writing becomes very important. Therefore, giving the students appropriate tasks for the development of oral communicative skills is important to get success in different contexts, college interviews and workplace, etc. This is the end of my presentation. I would just show you how I have designed tasks. The format is like this, cue card one. So in this card, a student one introducing him or herself, instruction is given. So this instruction will lead to the instructor, the participant to do the task actually. So here, expressions are given in jumbled manner. So he has to read this one and arrange in a good manner, then discuss with the partner, then perform the task. It is like that. So task one, it is like cue card one and two. It's a pair work. This is one example for the first one.
So good afternoon, all of you. When I was writing this paper, I felt that mine will be the hardcore ELT paper. But when I come to here, I understood that it's one of those. So my area of interest and my paper is on how teaching writing is happening in the context of India, especially. And my paper is focused mainly on it's a mixture of the approaches what we have been following since the ages, right? In India, we have been following different types of approaches to teach writing, which is not possibly focusing, or which are not exactly fulfilling the needs of our Indian learners. So if we can mix those, what will happen? So this is actually teaching writing a process genre approach at tertiary level. So my paper is focusing mainly on the historical context of second language writing, the genesis of second language writing issues, and the recent trends in teaching second language writing from predictive process and genre approaches in terms of their view, writing, and how they see the development of writing. And it also talks about the problems of teaching writing in India and how we are going to look at these problems with the help of this, the predict, process, and genre approaches. As we all know that a traditional Indian classroom is a very large classroom, and generally the students, it consists of the students 60 to 80, and sometimes maybe more than that. And which is a problematic thing to teach any skill in the classroom. As rightly pointed out Mrs. Suresh, a scholar, and as my friend said, Mr. Nagaraju, which is not possible to teach the skill, any particular skill in the classroom. And as a result of this, teaching is rarely student-centered, and most students have neither the chance nor the motivation to actively participate in classroom activities. English is often taught as an academic subject and not as a language for communication. Teachers are not able to get out of the old methods of grammar translation and do not use textbooks as a tool to enable language capability. Thus, one could state that, on the whole, the English teaching situation in many English classrooms in India is today a very, not very different from what it was 40 years ago. That's what I felt after, come across many organizations or many colleges when I went visited rural colleges. Okay, now next. This is particularly true of regional medium English classrooms. In these classrooms, the problem becomes worse because very few teachers are able to really understand the text and tasks. The content gets translated into mother tongue, and the answers to exercises, particularly grammar and writing, are dictated from many guidebooks, and it's very a pathetic situation to say, or I should not mention these things. Most of the teachers, it's encouraging. Teachers are encouraging the students in rural medium colleges to go buy the guidebooks or some test papers for the writing or for grammar kind of things. And another thing is, we all know that it's an acknowledged fact that writing is one of the basic paths to civilization. And it enables us to link our words and thoughts in order to express ourselves, to help humankind communicate across time and space. It can serve as a record of things that happened in the past. As such, one of the fundamental goals of all school education is to help students become effective learners by learning to think and learning to learn. This is a UNESCO report in the year 1972. But what is happening exactly? I have some questions. Even I too don't have answers. I'm just leaving those questions, right? And the other thing is, writing is therefore a powerful instrument of thought without which the thinking of Plato and Aristotle would not be available to us. However, writing is necessary not only for philosophers, but also normal human beings to convey their thoughts to others. This communication, however, does not come easily to students and learners, and is actually a very complex skill which requires both a physical and mental struggle on the part of the writer. According to Walters, there is a quotation about writing, what Walters said, it's in 1983, writing is the last, perhaps most difficult skill students learn, if they ever do. And Byron also told the same thing, also said, the writing is neither an easy nor a spontaneous skill, it requires conscious mental effort. But what is happening in our language classrooms, especially at tertiary level? Since it's a mental process. And this is the second question I want to pose, but there is no answer for me. And the next thing. So writing is a skill, and like all the other skills, it has to be learned. Although writing is important to convey ideas, give instructions, set out legal arguments, etc., most people have never really considered that writing skills are a skill. In fact, writing is a lot more than just using accurate grammar, what we follow in our classrooms, and choosing appropriate vocabulary. It may be more beyond that. And if it therefore becomes important all language classrooms to teach writing, however, the nature of this teaching needs to be understood as it includes many areas of writing.